All right. Our theme this morning is a continuation of our grand theme for October, which is Go to the New Place. If you want to follow along for today's particular theme, it is on the front of your bulletin. Here we are, ready or not, bringing our everyday selves to praise and to pray, to know the Holy One in the midst of our lives. Wrestling, struggling, resisting powers beyond understanding, embracing, reconciling together. Let us wrestle, let us worship that which is sacred. Inspire and inform us how to love one another, even and especially those with whom we differ. Fill us with the wisdom and will to love one another just as you love us, unconditionally, graciously, and ceaselessly. Let us worship together.
October 11th, we have our elders meeting for Zoom. And I believe on Monday is a stewardship meeting.
Maybe.
It's not listed. Maybe.
Well, yes, but yeah.
It is?
It says Sunday, October 30th.
Okay.
We'll see.
So that's true. Then on Saturday, this coming Saturday, we have our junk in the trunk sale in the parking lot. And it's basically like a large yard sale, so please come, enjoy, invite your neighbors, and we hope to enjoy that together. Next Sunday, following our church service, not really following, but at 2 o'clock, there will be the Atlanta Musician Orchestra concert at 2 p.m. And that is all I'm going to mention right now. Yes, Ruth?
Let me real quickly say, too, that after church next Sunday, the Chalice group is going to switch clothing from the summer clothes to the winter clothes. So anybody who can stay after church next Sunday, don't do that much.
Okay. Did anybody hear that? Okay. So in that case, we're at a point where we're going to sing together our first hymn, which is number 56 in our hymnal, and that is our fourth beauty of the earth.
Thank you.
I did forget one thing I wanted to tell everybody. Today is Friday. It's the last day of Friday night, and we only had some members there today, which is great. And anyone who wants to go, please do. It's for everyone. All right. Now we're going to have our call to worship. And we'll be meeting and then you move along, please. Immediately followed by the innocent prayer of invocation. God comes into a world filled with uncertainties and darkness.
God seeks out the voices of belief and conviction.
God embraces the wounded and broken.
God knocks down walls of division and strife.
God is a candle shining in the darkness of our days.
God is the light of our lives.
God is the one who makes all things new.
Praise be God, now and forevermore.
Loving God,
who touched and healed the broken places of our life,
touch us today.
You have healed the sick and liberated the imprisoned.
Who bring justice in the midst of oppression and strength in the midst of weakness.
Pour out your spirit of power upon us today.
Open our hearts to new faithfulness.
Redirect our waywardness and hold us gently in your presence.
Amen.
Why do you think I have a very folks ago, we had an MC, and someone randomly selected this song. Then actually, we went through it once or twice, and we did it around. But then I remember after service, some of you wanted to really sing the round all the way through when it came to English. So we're going to do that today. Now, if you notice, page 297, this is a canon, which is also a random. You will see that there are numbers above some of the measures, 1, 2, and 3, which have circles. What that means is, once you get to a new number, let's say number 2, I could continue singing number 2, then number 3, back to 1. You can start on 1 or 3, of any one you want to do, and it will overlap and create these beautiful harmonies that's called canon all around. So what we're going to do is sing once together, and I'm going to ask for some volunteers, like this volunteer. Maybe Kathy, you can kind of help lead the backside on one of the brown entrances. And Ruth, you can give the people behind you a cue one at a time, and I will give us a cue here. Got it? Yeah. Make sense? So those are your leaders, Kathy and Ruth. Thank you for helping out today.
Solid hold.
So, all right, so we're all going to get together. Then I will come in number 1. Then maybe you're coming the 2nd entrance and the 3rd entrance. Ready? Everyone sing in Dona Luz Pacha, which what does that stand for? Grant?
Grant us peace.
Grant us peace. Ready? 1, ready?
Dona Luz
justice a little bit. When I was in college, I took an intro to psychology course. that was everything. But there was this one illustration that my professor did that I had never forgotten when I think about it every day. You know when you're driving behind someone and they're driving so slow and it takes them 100 years to make a turn and you're like, please, why? Just, there's a speed limit. She said, well, you don't know what's going on in that car. Maybe they have goldfish in the passenger seat. And then I went to the goldfish over, so they're very careful. I drove home from Savannah yesterday with a cooler full of catfish in my trunk, and that was realer than it had ever been. I'm like, you want 10 on there, or whatever. I was like, please be gracious to me. She was using this for an example of something called self-serving bias. If you're the one in the car with a trunk full of catfish, you know why you're going slow. It's really obvious. Please, everybody, be nice to me because I have an extenuating circumstance. But if you're in the car behind me, you're like, please, Lord Jesus, there is no reason to be going this slow. Because you're not in the car. Yeah. In Galatians today, we read about bearing one another's burdens. Trying not to say minding your own business, but not getting into the temptation to look at other people and be like, I do this better than you. I am better than you because I do this in a different way. I know better than you, so I am. We talked last week about the fact that we are called to love one another in a way called agape. And agape means unconditional. Absolutely love others all the time. And Pastor James spoke about the fact that maybe that's a little difficult sometimes, and maybe we should shoot for brotherly love as a step up to that. But sometimes that's also a little hard. Sometimes we just have to try and understand. Trying to understand and trying to have compassion for another person does not mean that what they are doing is okay. It doesn't mean that it necessarily makes sense in the grand scheme of things. It means maybe I can see where you're coming from, and we use that as a basis to start caring. Sometimes that is what we do. Sometimes that's the best we can do. This verse in Galatians also talks about something that in our modern definition we might call karma. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Be not deceived, God is seeing everything. So what Paul is saying is, we should be gentle with one another, we should try understanding one another, we should try guiding one another in ways of love. But if that's not possible, that's not your job. Sometimes we meet other people where we can, with compassion and understanding, and then we have to let God do God's thing. Today, we're going to hear from a couple of different people. I'm not going to be the only one talking. We also have some testimonials of people who had to love one another through difficult circumstances. I am grateful for those who have chosen to share today. And I'm going to ask first up to be William Barton.
So how this happened was, I was watching a Wednesday at Thursday night, 6:01, midweek check-in with James. And you know, I heard him. I was a little concerned, so I gave him a call to say, hey, how you doing, my friend? And you know, he said, I'm fine. We talked a minute. Then the next thing I know, he asked him, hey, you want to talk on Sunday? Sure. And then I hung the phone up. And I was like, what am I talking about? But I have played this over in my head probably 1,000 times. So I'm going to do the following.
slowly, because most importantly, I want to protect those who have been affected by this topic, because there are victims. Someone in my immediate family, whom I love very much, did something horrible a couple years ago that has a criminal outcome for the rest of their lives and ours. And I can only ask, why did you do that? There's no answer that I could ever hear that would make up for what that person has done. So what I had to do is I had to separate myself from the family. That was hard. I had to take a step back in order to regain my strength and heal, so I then can one day love them better. And I hope during this time, and honestly, I don't know where they are. They could be in prison. They could be. I don't know what's happening in the sentencing. I just hope they've taken this time to get therapy or something to help them understand why they did such a horrific thing. Do I love this person? Yes, unconditionally. If this phone right here were to ring and say, hey, you're needed, I would immediately get in my car and try to be there. But in order for me to make that journey, I had to, again, distance myself and to heal so I could, in turn, love them better. Would I break bread with them, share a meal? Absolutely. Do I hate them? No. Should they be held accountable? Absolutely, because I don't want it to happen again to anyone else. So you may or may not disagree with how I chose, but if you disagree, I respect that. But I have to do it in order to heal. So, thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for letting me share my story as well. And really kind of started us off last week in talking about a parent. And I'm going to talk about my mom. She passed in May of 2020. I feel like my relationship with my family really has informed my relationship with other people. I'm definitely on a journey, and I'm learning, and I'm grateful when people meet where I am, and I try to meet people where they are, and it kind of came about this way. When I was 12, my mom said, I wish that you would run away from home. Yeah, and she meant it. But I came up with a great zinger response about a month ago. I was thinking about this topic, and I wish I had said, gee, Mom, if you just pack me a couple sandwiches, I might get out of your hair for a day or two. But I didn't have that skill in my toolbox at that time to kind of just take a deep breath and use humor and love, and because she was having a hard time, and she was doing the best that she could with what she had, but I didn't know it, and I didn't know how to address it. We really just don't talk about these things, or at least in my family we didn't talk about it. You just dealt with your emotions on your own in your room by yourself. So I held on to that little hurt, and every other little difference and every other little hurt that ever came my way from my mom. Until about 5 years ago, I got a book, and it was called Daughters of Narcissistic Mothers and How to Deal with Them. And it said, divorce your parent, cut them off, don't do holidays, it's okay, you've been hurt, and don't take it anymore. So I bought a copy of this book for my sister, my younger sister. I'm the older sister, I'm supposed to be the smarter one, but I'm not always the smarter one, because my sister read it, and I called her up. I said, so what did you think? Are we going to cancel Christmas? And she very calmly and coolly on the phone said, no, she said, I can totally see 100% why you would do that. but I can't do that. I would miss Dad, our wonderful Dad. I would miss Mom. I'm going to miss you, but I just can't do it. And so it took me a while to come around to that way of thinking, and I showed up for the holidays. And lo and behold, my mom was kind and sweet and funny and loving, and I was, she always had those qualities. They just became a little bit exaggerated because we didn't know it at the time. We thought it was our wonderful love that was flowing. It may have been, it probably was partially that. But she also had the many stages of dementia from Parkinson's. And it exaggerates your good qualities, which is a blessing out of that disease. And so we had a wonderful holiday. And that was the beginning of our 2-year journey with her, where she became just a sweetheart. And I got the pleasure of being with her and being her caretaker through her Parkinson's and being by her side when she passed away. And I wouldn't have had that. I held on to all those little differences with her. And my sister showed me the way. I'm very grateful. And I'm grateful to all of you for letting me share.
I went to U.S. Army Chaplain School for the first time in 2018. And I was a lot more militant than I am now. One of the classes that you take is critical thinking, and as an exercise, they get all of you in a room, your whole chapter class, and they ask you a question, like, do you believe in the death penalty? And if you believe in the death penalty, you go up here. If you don't, you go up here. If you do, like, in really bad times, but not all the time, you go in the middle, and then you debate about it. So we're in this class full of military chaplains. I am the only female. And she says, do you believe abortion should be legal? And so everybody goes, zoop, to the no side. And it's like me and 3 other guys on the yes side. And we start debating. And one guy leaves. The other guy leaves. I say, I believe that the mother's life is more important. And the lone guy next to me goes, don't you think that's a little selfish? And I said, no! Lord God, thank you for the gift of fellowship. Thank you for the gift of understanding. Thank you for the gift of your love. Thank you for the gift of grace that enables us to bear with one another, even through horrible things, even through disagreements large and small. Help us to continue to love one another. Even if we can't always see eye to eye, even if we can't always be in unity, let us not forget that we are all human. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. But we can also use to help. That's some stewardship. If anyone has anything they'd like to do and volunteer-wise, just call our church and ask. We always have plenty of openings for more help. And monetarily, this week I realized how difficult it really is getting to live on what we've made and how much it's changed in a few years. That's where the word faithful comes in. Not just stewardship, but faithful stewardship. We have to try our hardest even through these times to give monetarily and give ourselves to our community. So now we'll have Holy Communion, and it will be by invitation, which means everyone can come forward and have it. If you do not have a small cup, there are no sizes in the back, and you may be able to take one right now if you need to. Anybody okay? Good, okay. Then, receive the Lord, I also deliver to you that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he broke the bread, and when he gave him thanks, he broke it and said,
"This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying,
"This is my body, which is for you.
Thank you.
service, but this Sunday we thought we'd try something a little bit different. Since we've been talking about loving others and how difficult that is sometimes, instead I'm going to read our welcome statement as our meditation today. First Christian Church of Decatur, Disciples of Christ, is an open and affirming congregation. We welcome everyone into full participation in the life and membership of the church. Inspired and informed by God's love, mercy, and justice, we are purposefully involved in healing and helping our community and our world. We covenant with God and the greater community to nurture a spirit of love and service to neighbors, honor one another to persons, and to fellowship in the breaking of bread. Actively striving to honor each other's race, age, sexual orientation, gender identity, nationality, ethnicity, marital status, physical or mental ability, family configuration, political affiliation, economic circumstance, or theological perspective, we truly welcome all. Go forth in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, one second.